Let's get into it. Soul Not For Sale podcast. Coach Colin here. We got Joe Rogan, Graham Hancock, and Flint Dibble. Archaeologist. I'm immature. I mean, obviously, I say funny names. I'm immature. My apologies. they are still very heated. Something popped up. I watched this whole debate already. I'm on my second listen, which is wild because that's 9 hours that I'll never get back. But I do things while I do it. But let's just get into this whole thing. They're still in this heated debate. It's very tense. Graham Hancock is clearly very angry. But Joe Rogan ends up setting this guy straight on some things. Because, you know, I love when Joe flexes his authority or his muscle. You know, he's always very humble, and that's fantastic. But I like when he jumps in and kind of gets assertive on things. He kind of puts this guy in his place. I really like it. Then afterwards, I'm going to let you know something about why this guy, this Flint character, is pushing so hard on all of this. Really interesting. Let's get into it. And again, it just makes me not trust this guy whatsoever. Listen to this.
Suggests there's an archaeological conspiracy where we're all working together to have one narrative.
No, it suggests that there's a strongly held point of view, there's a paradigm, and that those who go against the paradigm are likely to be attacked, like Tom Dillehay, like Jacques Saint-Mars.
All of them still had successful careers for many decades.
But
Jacques Saint-Mars excavated many other sites.
Right, but are you denying that he was attacked for the very thing that you're saying archaeologists don't do?
No, but I'm denying there's a coordinated attack. There wasn't
a coordinated attack.
I've never said there's a coordinated attack.
On Dillehay, there was not an attack?
No, of course not.
Was there more than one person?
I have no idea. This was before I was even
a
scholar.
How many architects were involved in this?
Hmm?
How many, when the people that criticized Dillehay, that went after him?
Oh, a very large number. The Clovis First Lobby, the Clovis Police, as they used to be called by
other
archaeologists.
So it's not, it wasn't one
person. Well, think
about
how many people actually study the Clovis period. That is a tiny period in one area of the world. The majority of archaeologists do not study that. Even Americanist archaeologists.
That's completely irrelevant.
Most Americanist archaeologists study much later periods.
It's fundamental to the issue of the peopling of the Americas.
But it's direct. It's also direct evidence of a group of archaeologists going after this one guy for saying something that turned out to be correct.
It's evidence of an academic argument, which happens, yes.
But not that simple, right? Because he was correct, and they dismissed him. They wouldn't listen to his evidence, and he turned out to be correct.
What do you mean? He kept excavating that site. He invited people down there and convinced them that he was right.
If they didn't listen to him, and they didn't take the data, and they did dismiss him, and publicly, they still did all those things that you're trying to obfuscate.
I'm not trying to obfuscate anything. That's not fair at all.
But that would
invited,
what they did
it's
to
a famous
him
event
the
from the 1990s where he invited down a series of Clovis First people and he convinced them at Monteverde. They came down there, they had a conversation, he showed them the evidence, and what resulted from that conversation was that entire group changing their mind on stuff. I'm not saying there were not a few bad actors. There's assholes everywhere. But what I am trying to say is that it's not some sort of conspiracy of everybody in archaeology against Dillehay, against Graham,
everybody.
Against
said everybody.
And nobody's saying conspiracy. I don't believe there's a conspiracy against me. I've said that 1,000 times.
You what said you're public enemy number one.
Yes, I am. Clearly, Flint, to you, because you have, and John Hoops, for example, from the University of Kansas. I can play you some stuff from John Hoops, too, if you want.
So what is this right here? It says, to Graham, Jimmy, and others, we see you and we'll share with the world just how you try to bully and censor us. Who's trying to censor you?
Well, I'd argue that when people swarm me...
This is a quote from Flint Dibble, by the way, from one of his tweets.
Well, there's times when people swarm me and they...
People online, you mean?
Yeah, of course.
Tweet people.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, don't read that.
Okay, I try not to, but I have a small Twitter account.
Yeah, but that has nothing... It's just people. It's just random people.
I agree.
When you're public, okay, and you post something public and you get involved in a discussion about some contentious issue that's public, the whole world can attack you. So try to connect that to Graham or connect that to anything. You're just dealing with people.
Mm-hmm.
He's not responsible for that. You're responsible if you engage and read it.
Flint, do you believe that there's such a thing? You know, we've all heard the word big pharma. Do you think there's such a thing as big archaeology?
No.
Oh, how odd. Because here you are, Flint Dibble, January 23rd, this is 2023.
It's scare quotes, it's sarcasm.
The reality is we live in a period where we're seeing an increased distrust of scholars and scientists.
Yes.
As an archaeologist, I think we have to respond by engaging with the public, and we do. In many ways, the reach of big archaeology is way beyond that of Graham Hancock. Think about the millions of school children and parents who visit museums, et cetera, et cetera. You've just told me you don't believe in the big archaeology, but right here you said there is a big archaeology.
That's in quotes for sarcasm.
Oh, sorry, you lost me there.
That's
because
okay.
you're saying, so you don't think that the millions of school children and the teaching of archaeology what archaeology teaches us about the past forms the basis of the education system about the past, not people like me, people like you. That forms the basis of the education system about the past. Now, you like to present yourself as this small, lone voice, but frankly, by comparison with big archaeology, as you call it in your so-called scare quotes, by comparison with that, my outreach is very small, even on Netflix.
Graham, I was hoping we'd have a respectful conversation
here. Yes, I was hoping that you would not disrespect me in the way that you've
done. I came here to present actual evidence, and I've done that.
Here you have Dibble exhorted colleagues to mobilize worldwide in the battle against pseudo-archaeology. If there's any conspiracy here, who's it against? Let's move on. Next one, Flint.
Are you having fun?
The ball's in your court.
The ball's in my court?
Yeah, go ahead. Say something. Say something interesting. Say something new.
Say something interesting.
Well,
and new.
This is not productive.
I came here to have a respectful conversation. Yeah. I want to be very clear about this, Graham. I have critiqued the sources that you have used, and I've critiqued the evidence that you use. I have only met you for the first time today, so I do not know how you are as a person or how you treat other people. And so, to be honest, I think that you've just tried to go and smear me back for what you see as a smear on yourself. Fair enough. That's okay.
I'm just presenting facts. Yeah. What you actually said.
I'm presenting facts as well from archaeology.
Yes.
And I've shown you the kind of big data evidence that we actually have, which disproves your entire civilization.
Let's have a look at, it doesn't disprove my entire civilization. How could you possibly do that when you've only investigated less than 5% of the continental shelves, 1% of the Sahara, 1% of the Amazon? How can you possibly disprove?
How can you claim there's an Ice Age civilization and ignore all the Ice Age evidence that we have?
The Ice Age evidence that you have, I don't dispute it. Of course there were hunter-gatherers in the world in the Ice Age. There's hunter-gatherers in the world now. There's hunter-gatherers in the Amazon rainforest. There's hunter-gatherers in the Namibian desert.
I mean,
we coexist with hunter-gatherers today. Why shouldn't an advanced civilization have coexisted with hunter-gatherers in the past?
I mean, look, as I've said, I think you have an issue with the sources that you cite, and I think that you have an issue with the evidence that supports your civilization.
Well,
I think we should probably take a break and clear our heads.
I'm deeply unhappy that you have associated me with white supremacism, racism, misogyny, anti-Semitism.
I mean, if you didn't notice, it was always the same quote recycled. So I said something once, and then it gets recycled in 15 different pieces.
I understand, but you said it.
I did say it, and I said that there's this history of this idea, which has been used by white supremacists, and that's an issue.
Right.
And I would like Graham to separate himself from that history in a stronger way, because he goes around the world to different cultures, and he claims that instead of their ancestors building this stuff, it was done by his civilization. They were the ones that taught people around the world how to do that. But does he do that in his own backyard? Does he go to Stonehenge and say that Stonehenge was built by this lost civilization? No, he says it was built by Neolithic British people.
Because I wouldn't look for a lost civilization in Northern Europe during the Ice Age.
Why not? We have hunter-gatherers there.
Yes, a lost civilization would not be choosing to live in Northern Europe during the Ice Age. It was a frozen fucking wilderness.
Not everywhere.
Why would they want to live there?
Not after the last glacial maximum. We have people in the UK living there.
Well, it's not where I look. I look in areas, in underserved areas of the world.
We
talked about these mysterious strangers.
The lovely aspects of humans around the world, and then he goes around and tells people it wasn't their ancestors that did that.
No, I don't tell people that.
Well,
I don't. I'm sorry. I don't cite a
civilization that created it.
I don't.
He cites a civilization
well
that's teaching people how to do it.
The ancestors of the people that were there before, in the exact same area.
Let me summarize in very brief what I am actually saying. I'm saying that there was a cataclysm at the end of the last Ice Age. It's called the Younger Dryas. There are arguments about whether this cataclysm was caused by fragments of a disintegrating comet. This is the Comet Research Group. This is the Younger Dryas Impact Hypothesis. But I'm saying there was a cataclysm at that time. There was a civilization. Now, it's you, not me, who say that that civilization was an empire. It's you, not me, who say that that civilization, had temples and was highly advanced in every part. I don't say that. I'm looking, in my view, what we're looking at is a civilization like all others that emerged out of shamanism, but that went a little bit further than some other shamanistic cultures, that developed a highly advanced knowledge of astronomy, that was able to explore and map the world. And I'm saying that at the end of the Ice Age, that civilization was largely destroyed, that a very small number of survivors settled amongst hunter-gatherers as we would today. I've made this point before, but if there was a cataclysm on our planet today, people from our so-called advanced technological civilization would not survive it. We have absolutely no hope of surviving a global cataclysm like the Younger Dryas because we are spoilt children of the world. We do not have the survival techniques. The people in the world who know how to survive are the hunter-gatherers in the world today. And if I were a survivor of this civilization, I would head for hunter-gatherers and I would try and make my home amongst them so that I could have some hope of surviving. And that's all that I'm suggesting, is that a civilization that which had quite advanced astronomy, which was able to map the world, had a knowledge of longitude. I'm not saying they had machines. I'm not saying they had motor cars. I'm not saying they sent spaceship to the moon. I'm saying that they were destroyed at the end of the Ice Age, that there were a very small number of survivors, that those survivors settled amongst other hunter-gatherer peoples and benefited from their knowledge and exchanged knowledge with them. I am not saying that they introduced agricultural products to those people. I'm not saying they brought agriculture from where they came from. I'm saying that they helped to nurture the idea of agriculture amongst those people.
I suggest we take a little bathroom break, clear our heads, relax, come back, and let's discuss some of the ancient construction. Let's discuss.
Before we do that, can I just, the issue of the Olmec heads.
Yes.
I have no view actually on what they are, but can I just show some pictures?
Please.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Jamie. Let me get the, So these are the Olmec heads. Santa photographed these in Mexico way back in the early 1990s. They're certainly intriguing looking. I'm not sure whether they're Africans, whether they're Polynesians, or whether they're Maya. They could well be Maya.
Or Olmec.
I'm just interested. Yes, they're Olmec.
I'm letting it run a little long here because this is a very interesting conversation. I mean, it's fun to see Graham Hancock heated and handle himself the way he is. It's fun to see Joe Rogan let that guy know, listen, you're reading comments, and straighten him out on that sense, because he's trying to connect random people just tweeting to him as him being suppressed and bullied. And that's not how that works. But very interesting when you look at these Olmecs. I'm just going to say, like,
strong connection.
This one here, that one at the side right there, this guy, this dude right here in the corner, that dude looks black, I have to say. This dude in the middle, this big one here, he could be anything. This dude in the top corner, right next to Graham's head, he looks like he could be Asian. Maybe. And this dude, look, I know some white guys that look like this dude here. This dude in the bottom corner, I don't know, man. Who knows? But that one there, that one looks black. That's a very black nose and lips, I gotta say. You know? I don't, you have no idea. But everything Graham just said, that there was some kind of disaster and these so-called advanced people had to go live, isn't that exactly what would happen? Like, if right now, you know, we're so far away from any, you know, there's people who can hunt. There's actually guys who can hunt really well here, and they're great. But let's say we were in the vicinity of some uncontacted tribes, and there was some kind of catastrophe, something terrible that was, you know, AI. You know, let's just call it how it is, right? AI and just all sorts of craziness happens, right? Elon Musk brain implants all start shorting out. Everybody's working in a hive mind. And those of us that didn't get the procedures done, we escape, we run off. And we're near these uncontacted tribes. Wouldn't we just work our way right into those tribes? They wouldn't, you know, I'm sure maybe you'd have to war with them a little. Maybe you'd have to fight, and maybe they just take you in. But you'd find people like that. Of course you would. That goes without saying. I want to find... There's no catastrophe right now, and I want to find people like that who can teach me how to hunt, and I can just live deeper and deeper into the woods with my family. I'm looking for that now. So I think what Graham's saying is actually very possible. But here's the thing with this dibble. And I should actually look this up as I'm saying it to you. Here's the thing with this dibble dude, okay? He reveals in this podcast, they start talking about agriculture, and he's like, you guys want to talk about agriculture? And he gets real excited, and Joe Rogan points it out. He's like, oh, you got real excited about that. And he's like, yeah. He goes, this is my stuff. Everything else we've been talking about, that's my father's stuff. So right away, I realize, oh, this guy was warring with Graham the way you see him right now, because it's going to damage his father's work. Right away, I'm like, oh, that Harold Dibble, famous archaeologist. So that's why he's going so hard. There is nepotism in archaeology, obviously. There is extreme bias. There are narratives that you have to follow. And if you don't follow, you'll be canceled. You'll be attacked like Graham was and so many others. It has everything that you could see in Hollywood, in politics. It's the exact same stuff. And alongside of it is this weird woke ideology where it's like, you can't take away this from people's ancestors. It's like, who cares? You tell me ancient Egyptians were black, I'm going to be like, all right, cool. You tell me they were white, I'm going to be like, all right, cool. Like, who cares? Who cares? I just want to know more about the world. It doesn't matter if they were black or white. You don't all of a sudden get some kind of badge because, you know, Jesus is black or whatever. Throughout history, all those people are gone. You just want to know the truth. And it's so funny that these woke types, even this dude, this dribble dude, are willing to, in the pursuit of ideology and being a good person and not stripping away these people's ancestors, you know, taking that achievement away from them, in doing that, they would rather be good people than just talk about the possibility that those people or that their ancestors didn't make those artifacts. All just because you want to be a good person. It's so weird. It's weird. I guess it's not weird because, you know, woke ideology is very cult-like. And I guess the cult is going to be the same no matter what field it's placed in, right? Whether it's ChatGPT refusing to say something good about Trump, or it's archaeology not willing to look at facial structures of a face and be like, that looks like a black guy, that looks like a white guy, you know? Or it's politics, they're not going to say what a woman is. They refuse to say illegal. If they say illegal, they have to say undocumented, and you don't want to hurt anyone's feelings, even if that person took Lakin Riley's life. I got to do a video on that itself. But yes, this man, Harold Dribble, that's the guy's father. So the whole reason he was going so hard for all of this is not just because he's an archaeologist and that he thinks Graham's work isn't good. It's because if Graham is right, everything his father did is wrong. And once that happens, like, it's the legacy. And then all of a sudden, you are not the son of a famous archaeologist. You're the son of an archaeologist who was wrong, like so many others. And then all of a sudden, you don't get to walk in the... so funny. You don't get to walk into the door and be like, I'm a dribble. Or dibble, sorry. I'm a dibble. Can I get that funding? Carrying on a legacy here. All of a sudden, you're the guy whose dad was wrong. It's a dirty game, man. It's a dirty game. Let's check this guy's work. This Harold Dibble. Dibble dabble. Let me know what you think in the comments as well. You think those people look black? You think they looked white? And here's the thing. I can make a sculpture of a white guy. And then years later, everyone's just going to assume I was white because I made a sculpture of a white guy. Maybe I was just paying homage to a white guy. Like, look, there's a white guy right here. Right? I don't know, man. It's so silly. And at the end of the day, huge nerds, eh? I'm just saying. Not in a bad way, but like, wow. Like, just absolutely wild. How nerdy. You know what I mean? Let's check this out.
Hey, I know, it's take 50.
Oh, it's him doing a video about his dad's work. Wow. Talking on... Oh, and his dad... Wait, hold on. Did his dad pass away? Hold on. Did his dad pass? That's sad. I'm always sad if somebody's dad... His dad did pass away. Wow. So he's not just fighting... So everything I said, it still holds true, but I want to have a little more sympathy because that's really sad. But he's fighting for his father that passed. He's fighting for his work. And his dad's not here to defend himself anymore. And if Graham is right, then not only does his work get pushed aside and forgotten about, but his dad actually does. The legacy that his dad left behind does as well. Ah, true. That's sad. That is sad. I didn't realize that. Well, condolences, Flint, if you ever see this. I doubt you will, but condolences if you ever do. You know, it's always hard when dad dies. My dad died. Our dads died around the same time, too. A couple of months apart. Wild. Man, but anyway, one thing that he said, one thing that Graham brought up, education system of the past. Whoever is right about what affects the education system of the past, that's very powerful. You then affect what people learn as what history is. You actually rewrite history. So you got to think, again, bringing up this guy and his dad has written a part of history. His dad lives forever in that history. If someone rewrites it, they erase his dad. That's sad, man. That is sad. I'm very sorry about that, Flint. Blaming Graham for random, yeah, big archaeology. Of course there's a big archaeology. Of course there is. And it's so clear with just this guy in general. If you watch this whole thing, you can see this guy is, he's like the Peter Hotez of archaeology. He's just here to smear. He's not here to really teach anybody anything. He's here with some talking points. He wants you to get these talking points, and that's it. He's not trying to teach you anything. He has a narrative, and he's just trying to push it on you. He's Anderson Cooper of archaeology. He's the Don Lemon. He's the talking head. He's the guy that's bought and paid for. And honestly, just like all those names I just said, he has a deep incentive in the narrative being followed. If the narrative gets pushed aside, so does everything. He has to start from scratch all of a sudden. Imagine that. Imagine you've written books and you've done talks, and now all of that is just pushed aside, and you have to start again. And you have to start every lecture with, I was super wrong about this. We were all wrong about that. And then the person who you've been attacking, who you've been linking to white supremacy, now all of a sudden they're correct. It's like, ugh, what are you going to do? It's terrible. But of course there's a big archaeology. Just like there's a big pharma, just like there's a big media, mainstream media, mainstream archaeology. That's exactly what this is. And then distance himself. That phrasing is so, I want to say Orwellian, where this guy is telling Graham, you know, I'm not saying that you're a white supremacist, but I want you to distance yourself from that. That's him saying, I don't want you to follow that narrative. That train of thought that you're going down, I want you to stop going down that train of thought. We have a bunch of trains of thought here that you can go down, and those are more acceptable. It's like, it's so odd that in a field like this, there's this kind of censorship. So weird, man. And then also, I'll just end it with, he said for the longest time that he didn't say that Graham was linked to white supremacy and all these things, but he actually did say that. He did say it. And he admits it in this clip. It's wild. Wild. I love that Graham called this guy out. I would love to see more of this. And yeah, I'm on my second listen. Again, I'll say the timestamp is, if you go from 2 hours, 2 hours flat, to 2 hours, 40 minutes, it's where it's very heated, but a good discussion comes about. They do take a brief break for a second. They come back. They start talking about things. Into hour three, they start really not getting along, but it's getting better. Hour four, it's only 20 minutes left after that, and it starts to just, you know, they're just having a debate, and they're not agreeing on anything. Straight up. They don't end up agreeing on anything. Surprise! The guy who's trying to rewrite history, Graham Hancock, doesn't get along with the guy that wants to keep history exactly the same. Well, isn't that always the case, you know? Anyways, guys, let me know what you think in the comments of this whole thing. I gotta get out of here. Like, subscribe, share. I got a second channel. Go and hit it up. It is Coach Colin Media. Link in the description. I'm out.